Welcome to the Time Variance Authority. I'm Miss Minutes, and it's my job to catch you up before you stand trial for your crimes. So let's not waste another minute. Settle in, sharpen your pencils, and check this out.
Welcome back to Disney Marvels for week of July 18th, 2021. This is episode 147. Disney Marvels, the show about Disney, Marvel, Lucasfilm, Muppets, Pixar, 20th Century, the parks, and much, much more. If it has to do with Disney, it's fair game. I'm your host, Matthew Graykin. So, like Isaacson said, we wanted to hear from you about Black Widow. What did everyone think? Put the poll out there, obviously, about Black Widow. And the results are interesting. But I'll read them to you. I put it out there on Twitter and on Facebook. The options were, obviously, what did you think about Marvel Studios' Black Widow movie? It was either enjoyable, amazing. It was missing something, and I didn't like it at all. Well, 50% of you, between the two, from Facebook and from Twitter, 50% said it was amazing. 33% said it was enjoyable. So not far off, but it was pretty close. Nobody says it was missing something, but 17% said they didn't like it at all. So it kind of ran the gambit there, almost. A majority of the people liked it. And like I said, good for them. And a lot of people... I'm really glad people were digging the Black Widow. And I do plan on going back and watching it again someday myself. A fair amount thought it was just enjoyable. So, again, that's not a bad thing. But they're not saying it's amazing. A little bit of a step down. It wasn't quite up to par, but it was good enough. It was good enough. And then there's some people who just don't like it. And I've seen the conversations on a number of social groups out there that people are either they're loving it or they just feel not complete about it. Maybe that's the best way of putting it. And so the discussions are quite interesting. But like I said, when I was talking to Isaac, most studios would love to have this as their movie. A movie that makes $215 million post-COVID in its opening weekend. Most studios would be begging for that because no movie has done that since Star Wars, The Rise of Skywalker. There's something to think about. One other quick note of housekeeping. I said on Saturday that we will be doing another live podcast this Saturday. I misspoke. Not this Saturday, in 2 weeks. So not this Saturday, the following Saturday. We will be having it. It will be the 30th. Will be our next live episode, which will be about food and wine. Not this Saturday, the 24th. There will be no live episode this Saturday. Got some stuff to do with the family. So it just there's too many conflicts. But we'll be back on the 30th. And on that bombshell, we'll be back after these words from our friends and sponsors.
Hey guys, Ralph for All Universe here. Are you into nerdy things like Pokemon, Marvel, and Disney? You've come to the right spot. We have videos, we have games, we have contests. We just do all sorts of fun. Whether it's going live during the week or posting about an article about a new movie coming out, we do everything we can to keep you in the know and have some fun. Oh, and we have swag too. So come on. We're everywhere social media can be found, and we want you to become part of our family. Stay nerdy.
And now, on with the show. We'll be right back. amongst many things that Marvel has done recently, is just finishing up and wrapping up the Loki series. And as we are now confirmed, as though many people suspected and rumored and supposedly dropped by a few celebrity names, season 2 will be here shortly. And just like a good follow-up to a season, I had to bring Matt Leonard back on.
Hello!
But I can't, because the show was just so intense and so wonderful to me, I had to bring in another guest. Some say she is the better looking Leonard. And wow. That
I'm the one who said that.
Musical timing is only second nature to her Norse mythology. And when at a Renaissance fair, she knows which tent to go in to find the time portal. Absolutely. She's also Siobhan Leanord.
Yes.
How you doing? Thank you for coming on the show.
Thank you for having us.
Yeah.
We're just short of Leonard now that's been on the show. That's not been on the show.
I think we'll wait on the six.
Yeah, you're gonna want a while before you get Ben.
Unless your Padawan isn't quite ready yet.
Unless you want to start talking about How to Train Your Dragon, which case, he's your guy.
Strangely enough, Disney does have the rights to one of those three movies.
What? Really? We'll talk about you and I'll talk about that later. I don't know how that works, but okay.
Fox released the second one.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, we should talk about Loki.
Yes, we should. So, on a whole, what did you guys think? Now, we know what your expectations, Matt, coming in. I mean, maybe, Siobhan, let's get your expectations first before we get your definitive thoughts.
Well, whenever I go to consume media, I always kind of go very blank slate, and I go in to enjoy it. I want to get exactly the story that the storytellers are telling me. So, I try not to go in with any previous knowledge and everything. And I'm always predisposed to like things. And I did. I liked it extremely much. And I'm very excited to see where they're going.
You're not like your husband.
No. We complement each other. But do not match in this exact way. He looks bitter.
Is this the part where I talk?
Yes. You're allowed to talk now.
What was the question?
Well, we know kind of what your expectations were going in.
I had very mixed expectations going.
Right.
I had very mixed expectations going. Yeah. And I was very pleasantly surprised. I thought it was very I thought it was like nothing else I had seen before, and that was really good.
Nice.
Right. Whereas I kind of felt like I had seen Winter Soldier and Falcon, but done slightly better. WandaVision, I knew they were kind of going for this kind of, you know, Bewitched and Dick Van Dyke and whatever else there, and Malcolm in the Middle and these other things that they were sort of drawing on,
which was fun but not.
But it also kind of, but Loki was really and truly just, you never knew what to expect with it. You were always kind of off kilter. And I mean, and some of the fun of the Loki character, you know, he is the god of chaos. So you kind of never know what to expect with Loki. Even when you know what to expect with Loki, you don't know what to expect with Loki. So when you got to the show, it was that same kind of, even when you knew what to expect with the character, you didn't know what to expect from the character. And I thought that worked really well, and I think there were also less episodes of this than there were of the other two, right? This was only six.
This was six. Falcon Winter Soldier was six. WandaVision was
eight.
Eight.
Yeah.
Because that was done in half-hour blocks, so that right. One ran a total of 5 3/4 hours or something like that.
Falcon. See, Falcon Winter Soldier seemed so much longer to me.
Yeah, no, that was hour blocks, and that ran.
That really dragged, huh? Wow. But it felt new, it felt fresh, and it always felt like something different. You always got to the end and went, wow, I didn't see that coming. And one of the things that really caught me, maybe, might have been in the first episode, maybe it was the second episode in. There was a moment where I was just sort of looking at the art direction on it, and I thought, this looks Kirby-esque. This looks like a very this looks like a Jack Kirby panel. And that really, that's the first time since the original Spider-Man movies, the Sam Raimi Spider-Man movies, where I really looked at the film itself and thought, this looks like it's out of the comics. This looks like it's what it's supposed to look like. So I was very happy with that.
Just to make a correction, there was 9 episodes for WandaVision.
Okay.
Yeah, they really paid attention to a lot of details on this.
Yeah.
And I think because, not so much WandaVision, but Falcon and the Winter Soldier, they really tried to base it in reality and then pull the superhero-esque characters in through that. Winter Soldier.
Mm-hmm.
That's more of the vibe they seem to have gone with, that, you know, base grounded in the reality and then build the fantastic on top of that.
Right.
This, forget the reality. We just went straight, you know, straight fancy and, you know, just kind of whatever they pleased. And completely not based on anything Marvel had written.
Right. Yeah, that too. That caught me.
Where the other ones kind of took some influences from different other aspects.
Yeah.
This was completely original. And I mean, Loki, obviously the character, you know, is from the comic books. TVA is in the comics. So there is elements from it, but there's no basis that they followed along. Otherwise, and I think it worked out fantastically. I liked, you know, that not only did they just play with the backgrounds and the storyline and the arcs, even the camera work.
Oh, it was lovely. Know,
because
yeah,
there was points wherever you're watching, especially when they wanted things to be off kilter and askew, the camera would spin 360 as things were happening and just kind of, you know, kind of throw you off your visual senses, which, you know, translates very well, you know, and they didn't overuse it. They used it like 2 or 3 times, but when they did, it was very effective.
In the last episode where they did that, and I became hyper aware of it, and I thought this was kind of I remember it was the last episode or the second to last episode where the camera flipped upside down, and I became
the last episode.
I thought that was a bit much. But I also thought, and you said this to me as we were settling into the first episode or the last episode, and the Marvel Studios thing came up, and it layered all the lines from the movies over everything
very chaotically.
I turned to Siobhan and said, well, I think that's a bit much. That was sensory overload. And she looked at me and said, I think that was the idea. And yes. Then it sort of imploded on itself. Went, oh, this isn't just Marvel marketing. This is actually a director directing.
Part
this,
of the storytelling.
This is an intentional thing. This is a choice. And it's something that I absolutely hated for a second. It immediately won me over when I realized what they were doing. Oh, that was brilliant.
Yeah, Kate Herron, I think, did a fantastic job directing and coming with this vision and putting it across.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not as familiar with all her other work, which I'm not going to mention the names of everything because we do try to keep it a family-friendly show.
Friendly.
Oh, should I do research? I'll find out later.
Yeah.
Can I tell you something that surprised me? And I think it'll surprise you when I say this. Owen Wilson didn't bother me. I liked him in this. I actually liked him in this, and I don't usually like Owen Wilson in things. I find him sort of I thought about after you and I talked last month about this, we were talking about Owen Wilson, and I kind of said, I was thinking about it, I kind of feel he's almost sort of like the other end of the spectrum from Nicolas Cage, where Nicolas Cage has is this very low sort of Nicolas, you know, he sort of drags through every morning, through every movie. I feel like Owen Wilson is constantly trying to push every movie to make it better, to be in that scene, and that kind of personality that Owen Wilson has. And he sort of dropped that way back and brought it down and was still kind of Owen Wilson. He gave this sort of Owen Wilson-esque performance without ever becoming Owen Wilson.
Yeah.
You know, if that makes any sense at all. And I actually really enjoyed his character. He kind of almost sort of he's brought the same. I thought he brought the same energy to it that Clark Gregg brought to Avengers originally.
I can see that same kind of nerdy office guy.
It's not calm, really calm and controlled.
Calm and controlled, but also sort of loose and fun at the same time. He has the most fun when he's in control of the situation.
You know he's gonna have good stories.
Yeah.
You go drinking with him.
Right. Oh, yeah. He sort of filled that sort of Coulson-shaped hole for me that, mm-hmm. you know, that kind of a character, just a really fun, interesting character that, yeah, I want to see what they do next with him.
We can go back to episode 137 for people to hear firsthand about talking about our expectations going into it and your kind of leery expectation for Owen Wilson. And
very
Aww. He plays a great car. He does a really good job.
You were very kind in how you just phrased that, and that's why you're my best friend.
But no, I thought I enjoyed his character, and I loved how him and Loki played off each other. Because you had the like you said, the low key the lower energy of Owen Wilson, kind of his more subtle method. But then you had Tom Hiddleston's more eccentric character.
Right.
It's that odd couple. And even Wilson said himself, it's like 48 Hours, Good Will Hunting, that kind of
weird chemistry. Yeah, if he had gone the full Owen Wilson, it would have been way too much because he would have overpowered everything that Tom Hiddleston was doing. And Tom Hiddleston is a very broad performer. Tom Hiddleston is a very theatrical performer. He has an incredible stage presence. And I think that's one of the reasons why the Loki character works so well in the Marvel movies is what that presence that he has to it. I want to see him in some other stuff because I really enjoy him as an actor. I like what he does.
I highly suggest The Night Manager.
I've heard good things about that.
He does a fantastic job. I mean, you're talking about an actor that went to Hall H during San Diego Comic-Con in full garb and tells the audience, "Say my name." And just everyone ate it up. It's like, he just completely controlled the character, controlled the thousands of people in front of him. You know, just doing this skit, and you could tell he's loving it.
Yeah.
And two, the audience loves it even more. And it just was this incredible moment. And I think I used that sound clip for the Loki episode one review I did shortly after that. He does a fantastic job. I really enjoy him on screen.
Were you the one who told me this, or maybe I read this somewhere, that he going into the series realized that he needed to get sort of the cast and crew on board, and he ended up giving like Loki lectures. He hosted like a whole lecture to cast and crew so that everybody kind of got a sense of who the character was. It was one of those things that like it started out with the director and a couple of writers and a couple of key cast members. And at some point, the director and producers kind of went, everybody really needs to hear this. And so they arranged, like, a lecture. They got everybody to be heard.
Loki 101.
Loki 101.
And everyone go to classroom 34B.
I think that's funny because I think that's one of those things that kind of...
I did not say this, but I know Owen Wilson, who's not familiar with comics whatsoever, had Tom Hiddleston explain the character of Loki and everything he's been through.
Right. And I think that, I think it started with that, and it sort of spiraled, like, once they realized, like, not, he was not the only person who needed that information. There were others who needed, but, you know, the girl playing Sylvie needed that information, that, you know, some of the other characters needed that information, or some of the other players needed that, some of the writers needed more, and so it became this thing. It was like a huge lecture that he gave, and I think that, you know, in a sort of weird, sick way, fed his performance a little bit. That, you know, like, I am Loki, and all will to have that power and command. Not that I think he's any kind of egomaniac, but
he enjoys playing. But the egomaniac. The egomaniac. That's a fun role.
Yeah, and so it sort of, he, you know, he sort of. In my, I'm sure he sort of, you know, I think the wall between Loki and Tom Hiddleston was very thin at that moment.
Started dissolving a little bit. Oh, it's kind of like those portals that just kind of open up and you can just walk right through the other one. The, it's so weird to think that, you know, and here's a great what if for you. He wanted to be Thor.
Gosh, no.
And no,
he auditioned for Thor.
Right.
I know. I have faith that he actually would have been brilliant at it, but it would have been such a loss.
He does so much, I think, better as he is yeah. Just
on both
so
sides,
well.
Chris Hemsworth has the body of a god. I'm not afraid. No, I mean, and
especially in Endgame.
And Hemsworth is also a good, like, is so. He's one of those Marvel actors who has just become so Thor, so, you know, just like Tom Hiddleston is so Loki, Robert Downey Jr. is so Tony Stark. You know, Chris Hemsworth just is Thor.
Yeah.
Like, nobody else could play it the way that he plays it. And bring that kind of humor to it the way that he does. You know, so I can't imagine. I can't imagine Tom Hiddleston as Thor. God.
Yeah, it's kind of that weird essence of, you know, finding out, well, they actually wanted so-and-so to play this role. And then, well, for whatever reason, you get a different actor in that. And then to go think back that, okay, it wasn't. How could you cast anybody other than that? And that's happened so many times throughout film and history.
Yeah.
And, you know, thankfully, in this case, we're not there. This is going to kill me because I'm just trying to do this quickly. And it's not going to happen. I was trying to make a 1980s Hulk reference when you were saying about anyone else playing Thor. But I don't remember the actor's name who played Thor in Hulk.
But no, it's also one of those things. It's I know, like, it's one of those things. There's a great documentary on Star Wars, and they have some of the screen tests for the actors, and you watch them, and they're really, really good actors. You know, auditioning for Han Solo and auditioning for Princess Leia and auditioning for Luke Skywalker. Mm-hmm. And you have, I'm trying to think, like, who, like Kurt Russell reading for Han Solo. And Kurt Russell's a very good actor. He's an excellent actor. And you're watching him and going, no, that's not Han Solo. And then you have Cindy Williams, who's a great actress, reading for Princess Leia. And no, that's not Princess Leia. And then you watch Harrison Ford do it, and there's just something so different about the way that Harrison Ford just doesn't care. Yeah.
I need to fit. My paint is drying. I need to finish. Right.
hey, just,
I'm not getting paid by the hour here.
Just doesn't
Jorge, and, what's your name?
And it's just, you watch it, you're like, that's Han. You know, there's a grace to Princess Leia that Carrie Fisher brings that's just none of the other actresses have it. They're all very fine actresses, but you watch Carrie Fisher do it, and you're like, yeah, that's who Leia is. And I think that's kind of this thing, like, you know, you watch Chris Hemsworth be Thor, or you watch Tom Hiddleston be Loki, And yeah, that's who Thor is. That's who Loki is.
That's like
Loki in the comics is kind of goofy when you look at him, and Tom Hiddleston plays a character who's really relatable. You care about him.
Yeah.
So I give him a lot of credit for that. The writing is a part of that too.
Well, true. It's a combination of the writing, directing, and the acting and
performance. Yeah.
I wanted to bring up one an almost casting as well. I mean, we all think Tim Allen is Buzz Lightyear, and we can't imagine anyone else.
Oh, who else was up for it?
They called Billy Crystal first.
Oh.
Yeah, like that's.
Oh.
Yeah. And he said, nah, I gotta pass on this.
Sorry, that was Nathan Lane. I don't know why I was. Sorry.
Where did he come from?
I don't do Billy Crystal. I can do Nathan Lane. I don't do a Billy Crystal.
I met Nathan Lane.
What's that?
I met Nathan Lane.
You've told me that.
Yeah.
You didn't tell me that.
No.
Good old Joe Lane. But yeah, he
should talk about Loki.
Yeah, but I was coming back around to that. That we're mentioning, it's the writing, it's the character. Actually, in the Simpson spoof that they just put out on Disney Plus, there's a really funny clip at the end where they're mocking this the courtroom scene at the beginning of Loki.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And you know, she's like, "You're guilty for this and that, and causing mischief, and running around with greasy hair. Just wash your hair already."
Oh, he had a long day.
And coming up with extra scenes at making people wait to extra credits scenes during the credits that make absolutely no sense, but they're trying to make sense of it. They just completely riff into it, which sells the whole short otherwise. But no, I give a lot of credit also to the original director of Thor, Kenneth Branagh.
Yeah,
who I think is a fantastic actor and even just as good of a director, and how he composed that movie and built the relationship of Thor and Loki in that, and you really focus the movie in on the relationship and those characters so everyone got to know these characters to get us to this point that you know, we could just do Loki and have so much caring about the bad guy. You know, empathy towards a bad guy. And it's hard to explain. I was trying to do this during the live show about, we have to remember that we can't take Loki from the last point we saw him in the movies, because, you know, he dies. We're in Loki's future. This is Loki of Avengers past. So all the stuff of his mother dying, his father dying, Asgard getting destroyed, and him finally redeeming himself, trying to do good and killing Thanos, never happened.
I don't know how they got around that, but
yeah, and it was my number one moment from Loki was that scene where Owen Wilson sat him down in the office and played out the movie of the highlights of his life.
Mm-hmm. Right.
And just trying to think how anyone else would react to, here's what the rest of your life is going to be.
And it's not good.
And, you know, Loki kind of doesn't accept it at first. Yeah. Loki doesn't accept it at first. But then you see him later in that episode come back into the office and rewatch it, realizing this is all real.
It was hard to watch. I felt bad.
Yeah.
Like, yes, he was a horrible person, but.
But just, again, Tom Hiddleston just pulls that off so well,
mm-hmm.
that you kind of see the pain and the gears turning of, you know, the transformation. Because we had to transform before, but it took several movies.
Mm-hmm.
And now you got to go through that.
In 10 minutes.
You know, that's an interesting point that you brought up, is that you kind of. You can't take Loki from the last point, or the point where we last saw him, and yet at the same time, you kind of need to get him to that point faster. So that's a really crucial scene, yeah. I mean, and it's sort of brilliant on the part of the writers to put that in there so that you can get Loki up to being to the point where he is a hero. He's not the villain anymore. He is a hero. And yet you now have an interesting story because he kind of goes through that emotional range, and yet he's still the bad guy. And you have that duality through the next 3 or 4 episodes.
Yeah.
Just going to look out for himself.
Or is he going to look out for... And then you pair him with Sylvie, you know, who you also can't tell how much can you trust her.
I don't know. I for some reason, I always trust her less than I trusted him.
But yeah, I think that was kind of the idea.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
But... Let's talk about Sylvie, and then let's talk about the kind of the weird relationship that developed.
I was about to ask you about that. We were going to touch on that.
Yeah, we'll touch on to the narcissism part. But
he found someone to love
himself. He got in touch with his feminine side. Literally, he started making out with his feminine side.
Gender was marked fluid. He's all good.
Yeah.
This is a family show. Just, you know.
We won't ask about the alligator.
Oh, alligator Loki. Can we get one?
I have a feeling we're going to see alligator Loki again, I'm sure.
Oh, I hope so.
Even if they never planned on it, we're going to.
And yeah.
The fan outcry.
They brought Throg in as well.
Yeah, that was fun.
But no, we still have yet to truly see Beta Ray Bill.
I'm okay with that. I'm okay with the little one-off. The alligator Loki's all I need in that weird world.
Yep.
But Sylvie.
Sylvie, I thought she did a fantastic job. The actress Sofia Di Martino, who had just given birth shortly before the shooting began.
That's determination.
Yep. They actually had to rig her costume to help with the new motherly responsibilities.
Which was excellent. I love how, you know, be flexible. Mother's in the place. No, I thought she was absolutely fabulous at it. And I like that she was definitely a Loki, but a completely, her energy was so differently focused that she did completely evolve differently. But still.
And again, along with the writing, as you learn more about her character, and especially the backstory of how she ended up or why she's doing what she's doing, and I kind of say this with Thanos, the best type of villains are the ones that you go, I may not agree, but I understand.
Right, yeah.
And you definitely understood her point and where she's coming from.
My daughter and I were talking about that recently, that the best villains are the ones that have a point, even if they're totally wrong about how they go about it. I mean, that's true. Even if you go back to the original Thor movie, Loki has a point. Even if he's a little extreme in what he does, you know, dude, yeah. your dad lied to me.
I'm still totally team Loki the entire movie of Thor.
Yeah.
Sorry. He was king at the time. They should have obeyed him. But that's a different topic.
Yeah.
Bow to me.
They should have.
Yeah. Yeah. I forgot what I was saying. Again,
but no, about Sylvie.
Yeah,
you got her point of, you know, why she was trying to do what she was doing, because she was robbed of her childhood.
Right. And
correct me if I'm wrong. I don't think we ever found out why.
Yeah, no, you're right. They never really address.
Yeah.
They just show her playing with a bunch of. As far as I saw it, it was just that she existed.
Pretty much.
But they waited a long time in that case.
I've got a theory. It's such a good
theory.
Yeah, we'll come back to it another time.
Yeah, you kind of got my gears turning because I was going to say something too that could play out in either season 2 or one of the other movies. I mean, we don't know when we will see her again. There's 2 possible movies that will touch into this, possibly 3. But will any of the characters that we saw in Loki, No Way Home, may or may not, Doctor Strange 2, Multiverse of Madness, absolutely will. And then, Ant-Man the Wasp, the Quantum Realm movie, Quantumania. will supposedly go into the multiverse stuff, and that's supposedly where Kang the Conqueror is going to be fully introduced. That's what I heard.
We just saw kind of Kang light, Kang family friendly.
The no. better option, the better of the evils, the lesser of the 157 evils.
Well, that's what makes it so interesting, because, you know, Sylvie decided to go for free choice over everyone else's kind of happiness. But it's like, did she have a point? It's
yeah.
Well, and this is where I was just saying, thinking that could that have been the, you know, not necessarily the Nexus event, but for the events to happen properly for one of the other Kangs.
He wanted it.
Exactly. Because I, Renslayer supposedly has a connection with Kang the Conqueror in the comic books. So, you know, how that plays out in here, that's a whole nother story. Because that's another character that we kept on getting glimpses into, but we never got her full or more of her story.
Right.
I totally bought her as a principal, though. So she's
like, she did have that kind of.
Come on.
Especially the suits.
Yes, yeah. Yes. But I loved seeing her relationship with Mobius, just like seeing Mobius's relationship with Loki, and then being able to see the relationship with Renslayer. It was nice being able to see different facets of the same people.
Absolutely. I like the relationship, that how they played it up with Owen Wilson's character, Morbius and Renslayer, how the two of them really just seemed to play off each other well, and then you see the deconstruction of that relationship. And I noticed whenever Morbius handed her the pen from her school, she didn't question it. She didn't seem surprised by it. She looked at it and it was like, I'm caught. At least that's the impression I got off of it.
I agree.
So again, this is a character that, so you say she's looking for freedom of choice, or she's looking for the better good. I don't think she's playing that side. You know, I think this is a character that seems to know more of what's going on than she's letting on.
What's on?
Same thing, whatever the time keepers, I guess they were the three robots. When one gets decapitated and the other two start going haywire because they saw a decapitated robot. Again, she wasn't surprised by that.
Right.
She was more annoyed that they found out.
My robot!
How dare.
Talk about Mystery Science Theater moments where, you know, they're watching Robot Ruckus or whatever it is, and the robots are getting destroyed, and the bots are getting all sick and distraught by it.
How can I do this?
So she's another interesting character that we're not done seeing. I'm annoyed that now we're going to have to wait at least a year, if not 2 years.
Yeah.
To see how this pays off.
But I'm actually very curious to see how they're going to tie, because there is this sort of multiverse of madness that they've set up. They've sort of set up the multiverse in a certain way with WandaVision. They've set up the multiverse in a certain way with Loki. Rumors are that Spider-Man is going to have something to do with the multiverse. Doctor Strange, it's in the name of the movie.
Oh, cool.
But it has nothing to do with it.
But so I'm kind of curious, like, how they're going to tie that together. And I do run this concern for Marvel. The problem that I think their comic books have kind of run into lately, where something key happens in the Avengers but pays off in Fantastic Four.
Yeah.
And if you're not paying attention to one, you know, will I be able to go and see Doctor Strange and the, you know, Multiverse of Madness if I haven't watched WandaVision? Can I go and enjoy, you know, if I haven't watched, or for that matter, the same token, if I watch WandaVision and Loki, but I don't feel like going to see, do I have to go see Doctor Strange to see this all play out? You know, how I think there's going to be a certain point where that interconnectivity is going to, it's going to bounce back and hurt them a little bit.
It's possible. It hasn't yet, but they haven't gone to this extent either. But something I was thinking of, I heard someone else mention this, that they've now created a new stepping off point. So you can start with Loki, let's say, and for what we know, at least going forward, potentially, you could start with just watch Loki.
Mm-hmm.
Not necessarily watch any of the other films that have come before it and kind of have a understanding of what's going to be coming for, you know, what's coming after this.
Yeah.
You know, if you have not seen First Avenger, that's okay. You don't need to see
the
that
one, the one with Uma Thurman and Sean Connery and Ralph Fiennes?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I've seen that. You're
totally fine if you haven't seen it.
It's totally fine if you haven't seen Ralph Fiennes.
We encourage you not to see it.
So so you know, or the some, you know, some Iron Man 2
is listening to this going, wait, there's another Avengers movie?
What? Yes, we you covered say, this.
You saying Sean Connery played Captain America? No. I do this all day.
I discussed this with somebody at some point in one of the episodes, and don't ask me which one it is because I can't think of it offhand.
Probably me.
Well, it was either you or Isaac, obviously.
If it didn't have anything to do with anything, it was probably with me.
What's the show about? Nothing.
Nothing.
Well, something's got to happen. No, nothing.
No. But you were about to make a point.
So we now have a kind of relatively new stepping off point. You know, does it help to have some back knowledge? Yes. And you could always go back and watch things to plug in. You could, you know, watch the first two Thor movies, first three Thor movies, and you're kind of okay. It probably leads you into trying to watch more.
Mm-hmm.
But even just if you only watch the first Thor movie.
I like the first Thor movie.
The first Thor movie was brilliantly done. Again, like I said, one of my favorite directors, Kenneth Branagh, doing a fantastic job with that.
One of my we've talked about that. Do we just want to cancel this show and just play a best of the two of us? Because it'll cover. It covers a lot of what we're saying.
More Loki. More Loki.
You know, I'm. This is now what, episode 147, 146.
Good for you.
147 over 3+ years. We've covered a lot of ground on this show.
We should talk about Loki.
Yeah, and but as I say, you can just watch the first Thor. Mm-hmm. Watch Loki, and you don't need to necessarily watch everything else to understand what's going on. You're kind of relatively caught up. Granted, this is coming from someone that's seen everything that's come before it.
But, you know, the fact that Loki is bitter and jaded and, hey, why are you guys coming after me even though I was doing something bad?
Yeah. Well, I was only trying to control the world.
But then, though, we actually got pinged on the wrong thing. All he did was pick something up, and that's what he gets in trouble for.
Right.
Destroy New York, it's all good.
For being an opportunist.
Yeah. Oh, well, here's an escape, easy escape for me. Ends up in Mongolia. But then gets in trouble.
Loki's thing to do? Opportunist? Yeah. I think it worked perfectly.
Oh, another great scene. The gems.
Oh, these paperweights.
You have the Infinity Gems. How many? No, they're all over the place. They're littered across the.
I like that office worker character. He was fun. Just kind of like thrown, but kind of like, what are you? What? That office character was fabulous.
So did either of you have a favorite episode in all of this? Because I actually have a favorite.
I'll ponder while you I don't.
You're gonna crib my answer.
I told you, I'm gonna cheat off you. So take. I'll take notes.
Rotten Radar. You got it, Matt.
You want me to go or you want to go?
You go. Do you have a favorite episode in all of this? Sorry, I threw a monkey wrench at you guys with an out of left field question.
Well, I gave you my out of field question because it's become a kind of a standard on these ahead of time. Hope you told Siobhan about it.
No, I didn't. Was I supposed?
Okay, perfect.
Okay.
Oh, thanks, boys.
Hey.
I'm gonna go episode. Whispering.
Okay.
Okay. I'm gonna go episode 5, Journey into Mystery.
I think I know what yours. What? Which one is that? I was
the
talking
the last one, wherever they go into the end of time, and you run into all the Lokis, and you have.
Oh, okay. The party was fun.
Yeah. So you get the Loki party, you get the alligator Loki eating another Loki's arm, the whole battle where Tom Hiddleston's just kind of dancing his way around and no one notices him while they're beating each other up.
That was fun.
You know, I gotta... Let's do that again. you just reminded me of something.
Morbius in a pizza truck.
Have you seen all the memes that are... You see, like, Owen Wilson and Sylvie in the car, and she's like, this is a really nice car! And then you see it, and it's Lightning McQueen.
Oh, of course.
No, like, I haven't seen that one.
I've seen, like, 3 or 4 of them, and it's there's a whole bunch of them that it's Mobius and Sylvie, and they're driving Lightning McQueen instead of the pizza truck.
Nice.
No,
I haven't seen that one. I've seen the one with Owen Wilson on a jet ski. And then supposedly there's one of
supposed to end.
That's the one thing I'm upset about this show.
No jet ski.
I wanted a post credit scene of Owen Wilson on a jet ski. Dang it!
I think we gotta get. We have 6 more episodes. Gotta get it.
I'm sure you're gonna see Owen Wilson on a jet ski at some point.
You better.
But you actually just reminded me of something because that episode featured a couple of the clips that were like in the trailer. The Loki for President pin and all that. And I think based on, if you go back and you sort of watch the trailer, there's a certain expectation. And I think what this series did really great was absolutely none of those expectations were met. And I mean that in a very good way. Absolutely
subverted.
Absolutely nothing played out the way, nothing on this series played out the way I thought it was. I actually turned to her maybe 2 episodes in. And I went and I said to her, the variant is Mobius. I was like, I'll bet you that's what, I'll bet you Mobius is actually the bad guy in all this. That was fully what I expected. And no, that wasn't. Actually, I never saw female.
You're right, he was a variant.
Well, I was right that he was a variant, but I thought he was the bad guy. I thought he was ultimately the bad guy at the end of this, which would have been a great. I never in a million years would have seen female Loki coming. Never would have seen that.
That's the way you liked it. Never see her coming.
Yeah, and I thought that was, and I give Marvel a lot of credit for being able to keep that character under wraps and not tip their hand on that. That really was a shock moment, which I think was one of the reasons that I liked this show so much.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, obviously the IMDb had her on there, but they just list her as variant. And even Marvel, and this isn't the first time they've done this to us as fans, and I'm okay with it, where they told us originally the premise of the show was something completely different, because originally the series was touted to everybody. The series originally was going to be Loki popping up through different parts of human history and influencing different events.
True, technically.
And that's kind of one way of looking at it, but not how most people...
From a certain point of view.
Yeah. Because even... What was this? This was when they were announcing, I think, Phase 3, that one of the movies had a completely... And I think it was Thor, had a completely different subtitle. And it wasn't until the movies and everything started going into production, things started coming out that, oh, wait, no, it's not going to be this. It is this.
Uh-huh.
So they've kind of given us some misleads before.
I like that. And I like going in and not having it all done already. Like, yeah, right. Oh, I know where this is going.
Yeah, and I think, you know, again, credit to Marvel for doing that. It's not abuse. It is protecting everybody from themselves and building up incorrect expectations, mm-hmm. which I think going into different things sometimes affects the outcome and people not happy with how things play out. The one thing I'm not happy about is only making 3,500 specialty Loki charm cereal boxes.
They're what now?
Loki charms.
What?
You didn't hear about the Loki charms?
No.
I'm sorry.
Where are my Loki charms?
Should I have bought those at the grocery store?
What?
I saw those and I didn't think you drank.
Matthew K. Leonard.
Oh no, the full name with the initial.
I know. I didn't think you'd eat up Lucky Charms.
They're always after me, Lucky Charms. What are you talking about?
I'm sorry. If I see them again, I will pick some Loki. You want to go to the grocery store? Radar, I got to cut this short. I got to go to the grocery store, apparently. If you just want to end this and put on a Best of Us thing, go right ahead.
Just good replay, luck trying to find those.
Replay. Just replay the top five Marvel movies and a little bit of our discussion from a few weeks ago.
I have a lot to talk about now.
And and maybe throw in the Great Muppet Caper discussion just to make it sound like we're like we've wandered conversations as we tend to do.
And I'll save you the trouble. You can buy one on eBay for $200.
Wow.
Ah!
Holy cow. That's a lot of money for cereal.
That's the highest one.
It's a part of a well-balanced and very expensive breakfast.
Someone's being generous and selling it for $5.
Yeah, good.
That's a magnet.
That's a magnet.
Oh, yeah, that's just the magnet that came with it. You're right.
See, but
He will not be sold for so little.
The thing is, I'd want the magnet more than I'd want the cereal. The magnet I can put on my refrigerator and it'll entertain me. The cereal I'll eat.
Oh,
or I'll be afraid to eat because, like, well, maybe I could use this cereal to put my kid through college. Am I eating my kid's college education right now?
Tastes like learning.
Taste of knowledge.
So I have a favorite episode.
Is your favorite episode?
I liked the one where they were the first time where they were about to kiss. I thought there was a lot of nice character stuff between the two of them. I thought that was a very good episode.
Was that the one on the planet on the train?
The one after that.
I thought that was my favorite episode.
See, I liked the one directly before it most, the one on the train.
The one on the train. Because
you're starting to see them, and you get to hear a nice song, and there's a good balance of action, and just kind of their desperate push to try and do something that changes history so that they would be noticed. I loved their push for the, whatever the escape vehicle was.
Yeah, the rocket ship, yes.
And just the desolation of just, like, it didn't work, and the different reactions between the two of them. So,
yeah.
I think that was my fave.
See, to me, that one was kind of a very Doctor Who-esque episode, especially that moment where the ship never left the planet. Why not? Here comes the meteor right through the ship. Oh.
Yeah, I've never seen Doctor Who.
Never seen Doctor Who, but I think you just hit on a big thing. I said earlier that I've never seen anything like this. I've never seen Doctor Who.
Ah.
And as I think about it, you're right. This whole thing... not the whole series, but the whole Loki series is very timey-wimey, wibbly-wobbly.
Yes, thank you. I was just about to say that. I actually used that in the live show, too.
It's sort of Marvel doing Doctor Who.
Oh, I like that they're doing it with Loki. That's fun.
Yeah. But in that same way that, like, Thor is Marvel doing a Shakespeare movie, or is Marvel doing Lord of the Rings directed by Kenneth Branagh, you know, that same... It's obviously not Lord of the Rings, it's not Shakespeare, but it's so in that sweet spot that you need... that Kenneth Branagh is the right director for it. This is that... So it's not quite Doctor Who, and yet there's a very Doctor Who kind of vibe to it, which I hadn't even known again, because I'm not a Whovian. You know, I didn't catch that until you said something right now.
That's quite all right. Yeah, it definitely.
Thank you for your forgiveness. Oh gosh,
hey, nobody's perfect.
It's a weight off of my. That's a weight off of my chest right there.
This time,
Matthew. This time, Leonard. This time. Yeah. I think that actually helped me watch it because, my wife again, who's knows very little about Doctor Who, to her some of the time jumping stuff was quite over her head. And I think that's for a lot of people was probably, especially at the beginning, a little bit challenging to keep up with the leaping from here to there to another place. The one thing that we never got, another thing actually, we never got a really good answer for was the time bombs. Sylvie at one point drops, when we see her at the Walmart or whatever the place was, sends those through. Everyone evacuates. Things are getting reset all over the place. But then the next episode, everything's back to normal in the office.
What I had read into that was because she went right from dropping all those to going for the golden elevator. So I think she was causing chaos that all the agents had to go out and solve so that the time palace place, the TVA, was empty. So she could just walk right up. Causing chaos. What a Loki thing to do.
Yeah, that's not as long. Yeah.
I don't feel it was very well explained, though.
No. I was wondering if that was maybe an event in the future that we hadn't gotten to. Because we don't know at what point she sent those in directly. But yeah, I mean, that could be, very much be it.
See, the one that I was kind of expecting to pay off that I never saw, they never really pay off the kablooey gum.
No, they didn't. But they did give us more to the Miss Minutes character, which I thought was brilliant.
She made me jump when we saw her in the last episode. It's like, oh, God. Oh, right. Miss Minutes. Creepy.
Yeah, and she's, she's working both ends. And, she's kind of leading the TVA to... Here's what you need to know, and this is the direction we want you to go in. She's a henchman.
Yep. Evil.
Cute, lovable henchman.
Oh, don't trust those.
Nope.
Voiced ably by Tara Strong of My Little Pony fame.
Yeah.
That's Twilight Sparkle you're terrified of.
I feel confident with myself being terrified of Twilight Sparkle.
Didn't she also do Batgirl?
She's Harley.
Oh, she's Harley?
She's Harley Quinn. See, I knew there was a bigger character there she's Harley Quinn.
Bigger than Twilight Starkle. Starkle?
Starkle?
Starkle. Mr. Stark!
Mr. Starkle, I don't feel so good.
Is this for are you Mr. Stank? Yeah, she did a good job. She did a good job. Oh, there's Tara Strong.
Yeah, she got to evolve nicely, even though she never really changed our perceptions of the character by the situations.
Yeah.
You know, she was, even when she was helping Renslayer by kind of distracting Sylvie while she waited for backup. Oh, yeah, I'm going through these files. It kind of gave her that sense of independence that suddenly seemed a little creepy.
Yeah. Well, these are the files that he thinks he should read. Who's he? Read them. Twilight Sparkle, as you said. Nope, Batgirl, Harley Quinn, and Barbara Gordon, and DC Superhero Girls.
Oh, okay.
Miss Minute in Loki. Switch, Dolphin, and Audience in The Baby Shark Show. Raven in Teen Titans.
I think I knew that one.
She's got a long list for Puppy Dog Pals.
She's had a very healthy career.
Yeah. American Dad, DC Superhero Girls again, Teen Titans, The Loud House, Ben 10.
IMDb.
She's
I don't remember my life before IMDb. I remember literally the moment, like, somebody pointed me to that website and I lost hours just sitting there looking up actors and everything they had done.
Oh, yes.
Everything that, like, hours, nothing. I flunked out of college because of IMDb.
Wait a minute.
I probably lost most of my sophomore year of college to IMDb.
Well,
how old I am.
Well, here's the connection. It's not an accident that she appeared on this show, other than her great capabilities. She was also in Rick and Morty. And the reason why that the connection is there is Michael Warden, who created Rick and Morty, also was one of the writers on this show.
Okay.
One of the creators. So.
Maybe Michael Warden is one of the timekeepers.
Whoa.
That would be.
Indeed.
That would be extremely meta, as if the villain was like one of the writers of the show.
How dare you?
That's Chuck Jones level of. Remember that old Bugs Bunny cartoon? That old Daffy Duck cartoon where he's duck-a-muck? Where he's being painted over by the artist and then it's Bugs Bunny is the...
Yep.
Ain't I a stinker? I think Daffy does that to Bugs first. I don't remember. There's two of those.
Yeah.
And sorry, I wandered again.
That's all right.
He's a little wandry tonight, sorry.
Tonight? Have you ever listened to this show? Yeah.
Obviously, she hasn't listened to any of the episodes we've been on.
Have you ever spent 20 minutes?
I get it live.
Spent 20 minutes with the two of us?
Yes. Yes, I have. No, I love you both.
Fine. Cool. You know what we should do right now?
Talk about Loki?
We should talk about Loki.
Yes.
Yes. That was a good
job. Glorious. Burdened with glorious purpose of talking about Loki. The character of Loki tonight will be played by Tom Hiddleston.
Yay! It's what's great is that it's an option. It is now canon that all of us are Loki.
Sounds good to me.
Yeah, there we go.
Everything is canon right now.
Who is your favorite Loki of the Loki characters besides Tom Hiddleston?
Oh, Alligator Loki. Are you kidding?
That's
Alligator Loki is my cop-out answer just because he was so out of left field. I love Sylvie.
Yeah, no, I agree. She's... It's such a... Well, I mean, it's a well-written, well-developed character. I don't think... Yeah. But at the same time, if I've got a... Like, Alligator Loki is a close second.
Well, I put him as my Facebook profile picture.
That's right.
As you should.
Right, you sent me the message earlier with him.
Yeah. Everyone in the Facebook group will see that.
I don't know what my Facebook person picture is. Is Ernie. What is it?
Ernie on the Moon.
Oh, it is. That's right.
Yes, it is.
It was the Soggies from the old Cap'n Crunch commercial for a while. For like the two people who would know what Soggies are.
Yeah. I'd say you should bring back the Beavers, but most people definitely not understand that one. Yeah, so
good for you.
All in all, I think again another fantastic series. And I'm going to bring up a sore point for you.
Me?
Yes.
Why? What did I do? Why are you picking on me tonight?
Not going to pick on me.
Well, Isaac and I were discussing this, and I want to get your point on this because Isaac was like, "Why isn't Matt Leonard here?"
Well, I'm with you on this. Yeah, I hated Black Widow.
Yes.
Yeah.
So,
absolutely.
Do you think part of the problem that
wasn't on the show last week?
Yeah, Marvel has now going forward with some of their movies is we've gotten these Disney Plus series that we have 6 hours to tell a story.
Oh, good point.
To tell a more complete story, versus now having to go into movies where they got 2 hours and 15 minutes max. To tell their story.
And Bubba, that's an excellent point. Nothing's going to be as well developed.
Right. So you're back to now rushing things, different type of pacing. You can't develop the character like you had, you know, Falcon and the Winter Soldier. We get to see behind the curtain of the superhero life a lot. You get WandaVision, where you get the psychological end of what is going on in, you know, with Wanda and dealing with the traumas that she's had to deal with her whole life. Loki, you know, we get a redemption, and then him, you know, we get just 6 hours of enjoying Loki. The fate of the world is on Loki's shoulder. How scary is that?
It didn't work out too well.
The flip side, if I can counterpoint, I mean,
go ahead.
Do you need 6 hours to tell WandaVision story? Did you need? You did not need 6 hours to tell Falcon and Winter Soldier story. You didn't need 6 hours to tell that story. That was way too long on that story.
That did WandaVision,
I think you probably could have cut down. You could have cut that in half, and it would have been a better story as well. So I don't think. And also at the same time, and forgive me, I'm going to say something that's. I'm going to address the elephant in the room, which is that Marvel.
We talked about the alligator.
Yeah, I'm going to address the alligator in the room, which is Marvel doesn't make movies; they make commercials for the next movie. And I mean that's coming from someone who enjoys the commercials and watches the movies. I go to the movies and I do enjoy them, but you do have to face the fact that Loki ended with Loki season 2 coming. I mean. It was a satisfying series, but it was not a satisfying ending. It's got us all sitting here waiting for what happens next. It was not a complete story. You know.
To jump to another sci-fi series, Star Trek The Next Generation would do that constantly. They were known for their cliffhanger seasons. But at the same point, your season ended in April. You only had to wait till September.
Right. And you knew it was coming back, and and if you go back and watch Star Trek The Next Generation, some of those cliffhangers are a little more interesting than some of the other ones are.
True. But wherein this is, okay, they waited to the last moment to officially tell us. I mean, literally the last moment to officially tell
right.
us. They rubber stamped it at least, but still. This, we're going to have to wait till. We don't know when.
Right. We don't know when this plays out.
2 years?
And will this play out in. I think you were the one who was saying this to me, was that you've now got to tell. You've got to tell the Spider-Man story, and not have to, but you're going to have. The multiverse in Spider-Man, the multiverse in Doctor Strange.
Spider-Man, we're assuming. Doctor Strange, we know.
It's in the title. And then it's going to pick up, somewhere along the line, it's going to pick up the Loki story. So you're going to have all of that information in between the two. And you're going to get a stronger sense of Kang. In theory.
Now, if they have the same director, though, I have complete faith in them not meeting. That I feel the information will be presented to us.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So just like if you had missed all those other Loki films or films he was in, we got the spoiler version and we got to see what he had been up to. So if the directing is as high quality as it's been, not that I'm going to miss anything else in Marvel between now and then, but I feel like I would be able to continue. I hope at least.
Yeah. It's just a matter of now playing the waiting game.
Yeah.
I don't want to.
Well, exactly. I want it tomorrow or I want it this Wednesday.
Yeah.
I'll be even forgiven to say I'll give them till next one, not this Wednesday, the following Wednesday.
So, we already did all the waiting for the series to begin with. I didn't know I was going to have to wait for the series twice.
Yeah. And even longer the second time.
Ah!
So yeah, it's, I think that's kind of the tragic ending to it. That I enjoyed it so much. The last episode left me wanting more, which any good show should. We just don't know when we're getting that more. And in what form and fashion or in under what title. So that's kind of the one downfall. But I think, you know, in definitely in 5 years' time, we'll be all looking back going, oh, yes, I remember the first season of Loki, and then all this other stuff happened, and isn't it wonderful?
But the waiting wasn't.
No, we had to wait a year between, you know, for just part two of Infinity War, which became Endgame.
Yeah.
And, you know, I remember sitting in the theaters watching how Infinity War ended and going, I have to wait 12 months?
Yeah.
Darn you, Feige!
These are all being... It was a three-hour commercial for the next three-hour commercial.
Sometimes Sorry. The commercials are better than the actual programming.
I get cranky about this stuff. Just tell me a story. Just tell me a satisfying story.
Wardorfs, calm down.
Yeah, there is a point where I just want to hear the story.
Yeah, and I don't want to be teased to so-and-so will be back in the next movie.
Hence the last, yeah, that end scene in the Simpsons short.
Yeah.
Have you seen that part yet?
I have not seen the Simpsons short yet. I'm sure I will at some point.
Well, I would say watch it.
Okay.
So I don't mind if they put one of those little ha ha ha. What, you know, there's more going on if it's in a tag because you can choose to watch that.
Right.
If you want. Of course I'm going to, but it doesn't feel quite as much as you're saying the advertisement. If it's just there, it's fine.
It's the lead in, like you said, it's the comic book, you know, thing that, okay, you know, here's part of the story. Wait till next week, but make sure you pick up this comic book to get this, what's going on between, you know, issue 100 to 101. You have to go over here to get, you know, comic book 98 from there to fill in that part.
And even that bothers me. This was a thing that happened to me recently. There was a Marvel thing. Two of the comics that I read crossed over to one of the major events that was going on, and they both touched into my comics a little bit, and I thought, okay, I'm enjoying this so far without reading the main thing. And I got to the end of both of them. It was a Fantastic Four, an issue of Fantastic Four and an issue of Black Cat, and both of them ended with find out what happens in this issue number 4. And then when I picked up the next issues of both Fantastic Four and Black Cat, they were on completely different adventures, and I never figured out how either of those other adventures. One of these days, I'll go back and maybe purchase whatever it is I'm supposed to read to find out how the, because I think it's the same issue that plays out both of those. But I've gotten I'm going to read it, and I'm probably going to be really disappointed.
I've gotten to the point that I won't buy individual comic books. I'll just wait a couple years, get the graphic novels that bunched everything together nicely for me, and I can just read straight through it.
Yeah.
That's how I did Civil War. That's how I got Lady Thor.
Civil War was good. Have you read? Oh, you want a good one. Have you read Secret Invasion?
That's on my list.
Oh, Secret Invasion is so good. And Secret Invasion is actually one of those ones where it crosses over. Talk to me when you get to Secret Invasion. Because Secret Invasion crosses over to a couple of others, and some are really worth reading and some are worth passing on. But I will guide you, my Padawan. I will tell you which ones are worth reading and staying away from.
Well, I'm going to have to read it before the series comes out.
If you want a really funny one, read Secret Invasion, and then there's like a one-off issue where it's Secret Invasion Deadpool, and that's funny as all heck. It's fantastic.
I'm sold on it already.
Yeah, the payoff is wonderful.
Excellent. All right. One last question for the two of you.
Yes.
Who would you say was the MVP character of this series? I mean, obviously, Loki was one of the main characters. Sylvie was another main character. But who do you think really kind of helped pivot this whole story, this whole thing?
Crocodile Thor. Crocodile Loki.
For the one episode he was in.
Yes. For the one episode he was in, I felt he changed the whole series for me.
One episode in 2 minutes, yes.
Yeah, it was a turning point, I think, and in my life. It inspired me to be a better person because, hey...
Didn't inspire you to answer questions accurately.
No. But it was a turning point for me. It inspired me to be a better person much like Big Bird. But if Big Bird were a 4-foot reptile with a giant horned helmet on his head, that's what Crocodile Loki did for me.
I should reach out to Vogel about that.
No, I mean, is it a cop-out to say Loki? I mean, no. Loki Prime? Because I feel not only did everything really hinge on his performance, but it was in his interactions, whether it's his bafflement at the, like, okay, fine, there's an alligator, Loki. Okay, you know, or his reactions with Sylvie or with Mobius, or helping, you know, making his decisions of, oh, I'm going to go through the portal after Sylvie, or, oh, I'm going to believe what she's saying. Obviously, it's going to hinge on him. He's the lead character, but it's in how he did it that made the show so great.
Do you think we can trust him? As much as they keep on feeding us the line, I'm the one you can't trust. I absolutely think he's the one that you can trust the most.
Absolutely. But it's easy because we've been seeing everything from his point of view.
True.
So it makes sense.
Even along the whole ride.
Yeah.
Well, here's my question to both of you. Is Loki the title character?
It's weird. It's L-O-K-I.
Yes.
Loki.
Yes. But Sylvie is also Loki. So when you watch the show, is the show really about Loki or is the show about Loki?
Really should be about Sylvie because she's the one who's actually doing all the forward momentum in the plot.
Yeah.
But or, I don't think so.
Or, and I'm just
the real driving character, actually.
I'm just gonna throw this one out there.
Okay.
Is the show really about Crocodile Loki?
I'm not with him. I don't know where this man
is.
Is
it maybe about, but you said actually to
how early did you get him up this morning?
To completely ignore your question, to answer your question, Sylvie. I think Sylvie, I mean, besides obviously Loki, he's the title character. Sylvie is the one who really sort of, as you just said, pushes things along. But you brought up a thing to me the other night after the show. You said, we never figured the dagger that Kid Loki gives him, we never figured out what that did.
I did I go on Reddit after things and watch a lot of memes that people put together, and so I did read that it was from Kid Loki comics. So it's one of those things that if you read the comics, it's a ah-ha-ha. Uh-huh. And I just wish they would just do a slightly better job going, oh, this is a good dagger because it can XYZ for those of us who don't read the comics. But yeah, it's just
here, take this because it's...
Yeah, not just you're going to need this. You're going to need this because you don't have a weapon.
take this and eat it because it's really, really tasty.
I needed one more line to be able to punch my union card.
Exactly. They're like, nope, not giving the kid the card. Don't give him a single other line.
Can I also, since we're on the subject, we've touched on Loki, we've touched on Sylvie, we've touched on Crocodile Loki, we've touched on Kid Loki. Can I just say I was so thrilled that they gave classic Loki that moment of heroism.
Oh, yeah.
And I think that's an interesting thing, sort of going back to what you and I were talking about earlier in the show, or what you were talking about earlier in the show, about Loki, trying to get Loki to the point where he's a hero, and you see future Loki go through that classic Loki, your future Loki, or some of my friends have called him Kermit Collared Loki. He has that heroic moment, and I think that's, you know, and sort of says that same thing, that, like, you know, it's not too late for me to change, to do the right thing, you know, and that's sort of a future Loki. So again, that's a really good device in terms of reminding us that Loki, there is good in Loki.
And he actually had one of my favorite points of the whole show. When he's pointing out, you have magic, you're good at this, why are you guys going around punching people, you know? And I'm kind of hoping, because I've always wanted to lean into the magic aspect, because we've seen people hit each other, that's every other show out there, and, you know, I want to see more of the magic from Loki, so I'm hoping that's a clue that that's coming.
Yeah, but one of the things that they successfully did to fight that point, unfortunately, was in the very first episode. Oh, no, your magic doesn't work here. And they stripped the magic from him.
Meanies.
Especially when they put the flea collar, the dog chalk collar on him.
Yeah.
But I think you also have to be careful. You know, anytime you tell a story and you add magic into it, it becomes... And I know Marvel has actually struggled with this. I think any writer who's ever dealt with magic has struggled with this. It suddenly becomes way too easy to get out of it with magic. You know, how do we... Well, we use magic to get out of it.
That's what really defined powers. You know, he can do duplicates of himself. He's shown telekinesis.
Right.
Keep it, and that's it. That's all it needs to be. Just have a little bit.
Yeah, but someone brought up the point that whenever he meets Sylvie, realizing that Sylvie's a Loki, and she has the power of the mind control part, he doesn't go, well, that's a new one. You know?
Yeah.
That was kind of like a miss. Like, well, this should be new to him because he doesn't do that. You know, he does all these other things. You know, he could change his clothes on a whim. Mm-hmm. But he doesn't go into people's heads and have dinner with them and while trying to, you know, give them the third degree and interrogate them.
Right.
Good point.
But, yeah, so mine, I'm going to go... I think I'll go with Morbius. Because he's kind of the catalyst.
Morbius.
Yeah.
Morbius is the other guy. That's the vampire.
Yeah, sorry, the other one. Yes.
Morbius strip.
I'm going with the car.
Yes.
Because again, he's the catalyst that kind of sets Loki into his whole mission, as it were, his eventual mission of, you know, trying to get stuff going. And he doesn't he's not quick to write Loki off.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he always had belief in him, and even how many times Loki kind of pushed him away or went awry, he came back and said, okay, we'll kind of hear what's next. And you know, he believed some of the stuff that he was telling him. However, he started telling him, no, you are a variant. He could have just easily said, no, you're lying to me, and dismiss it. But he gave it a second thought, and he started piecing things together and looking into it. And yeah, so he was the catalyst to pretty much everything that Tom Hiddleston's Loki went through. And so I think, you know, that he's, again, that important character that to me was pivotal to the show, even though the show's not named after him. I said
it's named after Crocodile Loki.
Yeah. I said before the last episode aired, I would love it. Would how great would it be that the man behind the curtain, or the person behind the curtain, was another Loki?
I'd wondered that.
it would play out perfectly.
Well, I kind of want to see the timeline where Loki and Sylvie go, okay, we're going to be in charge of the TVA. And I'm like, yeah, I want to see that. I know we get to see other things, but.
Yeah, I don't think we'll see that one, but that'll be interesting. That'll be interesting.
I want to see more chaos. More chaos with our chaos gods.
More chaos is coming, I'm sure.
Oh, you know, more chaos is definitely coming in one of the 2 hour and 15 minute commercials that we have coming up.
Spider-Man, awesome. Which should be a commercial for Doctor Strange, which should be a commercial for Ant-Man and Wasp, which is, you know, can I just say, I have no interest in the Eternals.
That is very horrible that you said that, because I said that last week.
I think we're staring down the barrels of Marvel's first. I don't think it's going to do as well as some of the others. I mean, but you never know. Everybody, there were detractors. There were a lot of people who looked at Guardians of the Galaxy and thought, oh, this is going to be the one.
Everyone said Guardians of the Galaxy, first Marvel flop. Well, everyone said before everyone actually saw it.
Yeah, and of course, it's one of the best films in the series.
Like, everyone thought that would be goofy. My problem with Eternals, it seems to be, oh, let's get more super-duper popular, you know, powerful characters that could have changed everything, but they've just been chilling. It's like, I don't need many more super-powered heroes. Like, super
I apologize to people who listened last week.
That's right.
We're coming back, rehashing this. But yeah, I didn't say this, though, that one thing, they never really relied on the star power.
Mm-hmm.
It was the story. Owen just happens to have these people in it, and maybe we'll bring in some, you know, occasionally we start bringing people more of names, but they weren't necessarily the main characters.
What they did, what Marvel did really well going into the Avengers, and they were smart about this because you saw it coming when you knew that Iron Man was going to be part of something bigger, you know, and then you got the Captain America and you had Chris Evans, who was kind of a big deal, but you also, his star was on the rise, but you also had Hugo Weaving. You also had Stanley Tucci in there. You had Tommy Lee Jones, and they were really your star power. And then you got to Thor, and you have Chris Hemsworth and Tom Hiddleston, who are complete unknowns. But then you had Natalie Portman, who was a well-known actress, and Anthony Hopkins, who was well-known, and there's your star power. And there was kind of that balance between get somebody really big, get an unknown or a slightly unknown to headline, and then put some really big names behind them that we don't have to use in every film. You know, Marvel was really smart about how they did those first couple of films. But you were just saying that you think this is the one where they're really relying more on their star power to bring people in than...
It to me, that's how it feels like. It's like, oh, it's got Angelina Jolie in it. It's got this person. It's got that person. It's got a mile-long list of people that they're touting their credibility.
Yeah.
There we go. Thank you.
Which is, I hadn't realized who was in it. So let's see. We have people that I've somehow misplaced.
You lost them again.
I keep losing all the people. Oh, yeah. So Salma Hayek,
Angelina Jolie. I don't know who that person is.
Kit Harington. Yeah, I don't know.
Eric, son of Eric.
I don't really know anybody else on the list, but that's already some pretty big.
Yeah.
And they're supposed to be, I guess, more major characters. At least that's how it's being touted, even though some of them have not appeared in the teaser yet.
Oh, but Kit Harington is the Black Knight. Oh, that's okay. That'll be fun. It seems a little obvious in terms of casting, for my money, but
as I hadn't looked at the cast list, I had just seen one of the trailers, but I hadn't paid very good attention.
All right. Yeah, but, you know, I think it's one of those Iron Man with, well, you never know. Yeah, I think, you know, I was just thinking, when they did Iron Man at the time, in the comic books, Iron Man was really kind of like a B-level, C-level character. He really wasn't, you know, and then it was Robert Downey Jr., you know, you were leaning a little bit on Robert Downey Jr.'s star power to hopefully get you across the finish line. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, Iron Man was everywhere, and he was, like, the lead. He was the face of Marvel. And I think they're now into that, like, okay, so now who are the B and C level characters? But honestly, the Eternals, I don't even know. I don't know anything about any of these characters.
I know nothing of them.
I mean, even Guardians.
A lot of these characters.
I knew a little bit going in.
Yeah, I knew, like, Guardians, I knew almost nothing about other than they had a talking raccoon in a tree. So that wasn't something that I knew much of. Obviously, I knew who Iron Man was. I knew who Captain America was. I knew who Thor was, who Loki was. Vicariously, just, you know, from skimming through different comic books. So as things progressed, I knew who some of these characters were. But this one, I know very little, and the little bit that they've shown us, I just kind of like, I'll catch that when it comes to DVD, Blu-ray, streaming, it whatever.
I realized after the fact of Black Widow, after I'd been out of it for a few hours, like, oh, I could have waited on Disney Plus. Had I made that realization while I was in the movie theater, I would have left the movie theater. Sorry, we've gone back to how I hated
it. See, and Isaac and I both go, I think we actually made the better choice by not going to the theater and just watching on Disney Plus.
Yeah, and I think that's going to be the Eternals. I think the Eternals, I may wait for it to hit Disney Plus 2 months later and watch it then.
Also, knowing that this movie was made 2.5 years ago.
Yeah.
Wow, really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was supposed to come out last November, and I think even that was a pushback.
Yeah.
That's not.
So right. This
wasn't supposed to hit last summer, I think, originally.
Yeah. I think even at some point it was maybe a late 19 release, and then it got pushed back to 2020, and then obviously it got now pushed to 21. This movie's been done for a while. So to the best of my knowledge, it has very little to do with the story arcs that are going to be coming forward. You know, or at least what we know already.
That's the one selling point you've given me, because I'm the one who's always complaining about, I just want a standalone story. I just want to enjoy the movie on its own. Maybe I'll go see the Eternals.
Well, you had that in Black Widow and you hated it.
This is also true.
Shang-Chi, I'm excited for. I'm looking forward to that movie.
I'm looking forward to Shang-Chi.
Spider-Man, because I think
Shang-Chi will be a story on its own.
Yeah.
It's Shang-Chi and the Legend of the Ten Rings, so I'm kind of hoping it'll tie into the original Iron Man a little bit, because that was always Favreau's plan, was that the Ten Rings were supposed to be like a larger part of the Marvel universe. There's something like it's been a while since I've seen them, but there's some piece of information that's given to the bad guy in Iron Man 2, and supposedly like the person who gives it to him is one of the Brotherhood of the Ten Rings, was at least Favreau's thinking.
Hammer? Hammer?
No. It's given to
Whiplash.
Whiplash. Somebody gives not Mickey Rooney. What's his name? Mickey Rooney. Mickey Rooney did not play Whiplash.
That'd be hysterical.
That would be one.
Wow. I want to watch that.
Well, Willikers, Judy, he ripped off my arc design.
Rourke. Mickey Rourke.
Thank you.
I heard Mickey. I'm like, yeah, it's Mickey. No.
Mickey Rooney is Whiplash.
Mickey Mouse.
And Judy Garland is the Black Widow.
Excellent.
Well, now, if they had made Black Widow into a musical, I would have enjoyed it more. I've forgotten what I was saying.
Iron Man.
There's a thing. Like, I think it's like there's a piece of it. I'll have to go back and look at the movie later, but there's like a piece of information that ends up in Whiplash's hand, in Mickey Rourke and Tom's hands. And there's someone who like hands him this piece of paper. I think it's the piece of paper that says like Tony Stark will be in Monte Carlo or whatever. And it's supposedly, according to Favreau, it's the guy who hands it to him is part of the Ten Rings, the Brotherhood of the Ten Rings. That was always supposed to be a bigger part of the Marvel Universe, and they just kind of never got there with it. So I'd really like to see Shang-Chi tie into that. Whether that'll happen or not, I don't know.
I hope so, because they do set that up.
Right.
I mean, everyone complained about Iron Man 3, but if you follow up with the one-up.
I haven't seen that yet. I keep meaning to.
You get the fact that, you know, obviously he's an imposter. The real one's out there and knows of what is going on with the imposter Mandarin. So they've already set the groundwork for that. Now, I hope, like you said, they follow through with that and bring this in. At this time, they haven't labeled the guy with the 10 rings as the Mandarin.
Right.
But like I said, they do lead to deceive at times, not giving us all the information.
I also just like a good kung fu movie, and it's been a long time since I've seen. They don't make good kung fu. They don't make kung fu movies anymore. Although this is a Hollywood kung fu movie, not like a real traditional kung fu movie, so it could be anybody's.
Hopefully, it's good.
There's a great.
You know, they brought in kung fu, informed people.
I've seen him say this a couple times in interviews. There's a great interview with Jackie Chan where he talks about American movies and why he doesn't do American movies anymore and why he doesn't like it. And he talks about the rhythm of American action movies versus sort of Japanese or Korean. It's the rhythm. And that I'm going to butcher, unfortunately, what Jackie Chan is saying, but he says if you watch a traditional kung fu movie, it's boom, ba boom, ba boom, 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 ba boom, ba boom, ba dum, bum, bum, and it's got a rhythm to it. And when you watch an American action movie, it's bum, 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 bum. There's no rhythm to it. And I actually, I was like, that was one of the first things. 20 minutes into one of the many things that bothered me last week with Black Widow, 20 minutes into the film was, and I was bored. And when I stopped being bored, I was offended. So.
Well, and I think, but part of the problem with Black Widow, you got into that action part, but then it like dead stop.
Yeah.
And then we got into like, it was more nonsense comedy.
Yeah.
Oh, we don't have enough gas to be able to get us to. Yes, we do. Keep flying. And you see the helicopter drop and everyone just walk out. I told you I didn't have enough gas.
Right.
Oh, that sounds awesome.
Yeah, that it was stuff like that that didn't sit well with me because that was not the movie that we should have gotten. I feel we should have gotten, especially had you had the opening scene. Just the title sequence was kind of darker and gritty, and I wanted a dark, gritty movie because Black Widow's past is dark and gritty. And you set up with, I'm not sure, I asked Isaac this, he didn't know the show either, The Americans, which was a FX show, which is about Russian spies living in United States and influencing things and doing stuff and sending information back during the 80s, 70s and 80s, which is exactly how Black Widow started off.
Right.
And I wanted more stuff like that and getting into the darker aspects of the Red Room. And, you know, and they told us a little bit, but they were afraid to go there, and they bring in these lighthearted stuff and, you know, the Red Guardian arm wrestling people and breaking someone's arm. And don't get me started. We already did this episode.
I would have liked a good spy movie. I would have liked Black Widow to have been more of a James Bond.
They were going Jason Bourne, not James Bond.
Yeah.
And we needed more Bond than. But anyway,
last week's episode. Sorry. This was last week's episode.
Yes, it was.
Sorry.
So, on a whole, let's see. What would you kind of grade would you give Loki out of 10? 10 being the best, 1 being the least. Loki, not Black Widow.
But I'm gonna give it. I'd give it an 8 plus a severed hand.
Okay.
I don't know what we're actually talking about, but I'm giving it eight. Can I give it 8 severed hands and a crocodile Loki?
Sure.
Okay, that's my. I don't know what our. I give it 8 severed, or do I give it 8 crocodile Lokis? I'm gonna give it 8 crocodile Lokis and a severed hand. I feel like the severed hand is the. I think the crocodile Loki is the larger point there, and then the severed hand is kind of like an 8.5 kind of a thing. But not in a numerical value. It's eight. It's whatever value you ascribe to Crocodile Loki, and then whatever value you ascribe to a severed hand.
I'll give it an 8.5 then for you.
You're messing up my grading system.
She's the teacher. She knows the grading system.
This is why we give him the curve. Have nice things.
We have a rubric, Matt. We brought a rubric.
Yes.
Is that the little square cube puzzle that I can never get back? We're supposed to get all the colors on the same side.
I'm gonna say yes.
Okay.
Just say yes.
I can only
fix it if I break it.
I'm rating it 9 planet destroying meteors.
Nice.
Very good. I will see your 9 planet destroying meteors and give it 9 ghastly, beastly giants.
Oh, nice. Wow, I didn't think you'd ever use me as a rating system.
So, Siobhan, what is in that bottle that he keeps drinking from?
It's water!
Alas, it's only water. We didn't get any sleep last night due to a thunderstorm and a 6-year-old climbing into bed with us, so yeah. We're a little loopy.
I tried doing a live show during a thunderstorm and getting tornado warnings.
Oh, that was fun.
Fun.
Yeah.
I got you beat. I had to do a last summer. I had to do, not that your listeners care about this, I had to do a virtual puppet show. And it was great. I was doing a puppet show for a library. I was doing it virtually. And I literally did the introduction and I said, you know.
Really? No, virtually.
There's a tornado warning where I am right now, so if the show cuts out, and I said something like, I'm going to start presenting, and I gave the title of my show, and then said, though this may end as the Wizard of Oz, and I went back in behind my little puppet stage booth, and I couldn't have been more than 2 minutes into the show, and the power kicked out, and then I had to, like, frantically contact my thankfully, I had my cell phone, and I was able to send a quick email to my contact and say, look, the power cut out. I'm sorry, we'll reschedule. But, yeah, I ended up not doing the show, so maybe my story doesn't beat yours. I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's all right.
You attempted.
I give that story 3 severed hands and a crocodile Loki. Frog Thor cameo. I give it 2 Frog Thor cameos.
On a pear tree?
On a pear tree.
Best place to be.
Yeah.
Thank you. What?
Please. Just.
I need to put him to bed.
End it now.
Yes. We need to put him down.
Oh, no, no, no. Not that. I'll just tuck him in.
And on that bombshell, thank you both for coming on, Siobhan. I hope we didn't traumatize you too much.
Thank you for having us.
Never.
Thank you for having us. Yeah. I don't know why you continue to have me, but I'm still here. I hated Black Widow.
Go back in your balcony.
I liked Loki. I hated Black Widow. And I don't know. We'll figure out what you and I are going to talk about next.
We like him.
We like you.
I like you both.
You're much better. You were much better than Black Widow, and you're much better than Loki. I give you 9 disturbing animated clock faces.
that sounds like a pony.
Yes,
that sounds. I appreciate like it. Thank you again, both. Thank you so much, and we'll definitely do this again soon.
All right. Thank you for having us.
Thank you again to Siobhan and, of course, Matt, but mostly thank you to Siobhan for joining us on this episode and discussing Loki. And we want to hear, what did you think of the first season of Loki? What were some of your favorite moments, favorite episode, favorite characters? Let us all know. Join us on our Facebook group, facebook.com/group/DisneyMarvelsPodcast. On Instagram at Disney Marvels Podcast, TikTok at Disney Marvels Podcast, and on Twitter at Disney Marvels. And also find us on YouTube. Make sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel where we go live on Saturday nights. Also remember my comment at the beginning, not this Saturday night, the 24th, but we will be coming back on the 30th for our live episodes. A lot of fun. Make sure you join in there where we get to talk more or less virtually in person and you get to be part of the show. Speaking of being part of the show, leave us a voice message through the Anchor app or anchor.fm website, or record it through your electronic device and email it to the show, along with any suggestions or comments that you have, to disneymarvels@gmail.com. You would hear yourself on the show this way. And don't forget to check out our Disney Marvels blog at disneymarvels.blogspot.com. Links to all of these are in the show notes. I want to thank you for your time. I know how little time we all have these days. Knowing what we get to spend a little time together means a lot to me. I honestly cannot thank you enough. But I can, if you just could, one more thing, go onto Apple Podcasts, leave a rating and review on there to help others find out about the show. Apple, the more reviews that we get, Apple will do their part also to help promote the show. We have all 5-star ratings right now. I'd love to see it keep growing because I mean it from the bottom of my heart, that the fact that you all think that much of this show, I cannot thank you enough. For as long as I've been doing this show, I never expected it to be 147 episodes later and getting that kind of review and feedback of how much you all enjoy the show and like the show. So thank you. And all I ask, go onto Apple Podcasts, give it a review. Always prefer it a 5-star, but give it a review, or tell people. Even better, tell someone directly. Tell a friend, tell a relative. Share it out on the social networks that you are listening to Disney Marvels podcast. This way other people can find out about this show, and the family keeps growing. The bigger the family, the better. Walt believed in a big Disney family, and so do I. Don't forget to subscribe to the show while you're at it. This way you always know when new episodes are posted. And also consider becoming a premium subscriber to help the show out. Keep the lights on, as it were. You could do this over at anchor.fm/DisneyMarvels/support, or find our Patreon page where you can get yourself some cool Disney Marvel stuff. And also find our merchandise shop where you can get yourself some fun Disney Marvels shirts, hoodies, different things. Check it out. Got a lot of cool stuff on there. Helps the show out that way as well. And they're always running sales, so make sure you take advantage of that. Because remember, this show is brought to you by listeners like you. Whatever fate you're facing out there, whatever darkness, whatever troubles that seem to be bothering you, don't give up. Please, please don't ever give up. Find someone. So there's people out there who want to help you. You are not alone, and you are worth it. You are special. You are something amazing. You are someone amazing. There's a light inside of you that is waiting to be shown to the whole world, to light the darkness that other people may be living in. Your guiding light is unique because it's only from you. No one else has that kind of light. Be your own hero. Never give up and never give in. And now I'd like to end this week's show with a quote from Walt Disney himself. I'm a patient listener, but opinionated to the point of stubbornness when my mind is made up. Again, that's from Walt Disney. Thank you again for listening, everyone, and I'll see you next time.
Men tränar och dansar och fasar och stansar. Now hon singer, kom hem. Men tränar och dansar och fasar och stansar. When she sings, come home. When she sings, come home. Men tränar och dansar och fasar och stansar. Now hon singer, kom hem. Men tränar och dansar och fasar och stansar. When she sings, come home. When she sings, come home. When she sings, come home. When she sings, come home.